Straight away, we'll be going to the colloquium. We are here, and one of the things we must take away is a little bit more, learning more about the environment in which we operate. And the colloquium we're going to be having has the theme, Delays in Project Delivery in the Construction Industry, Causes and Solutions. For the next few minutes, I will have the pleasure to invite to the podium the moderator as well as the members who will discuss this very vital topic. I have the pleasure to invite to the podium the moderator, Engineer Bayo Adeola. Let's put our hands together as he comes. Do we have ushers in the house? Okay, let's put our hands together as he comes. To discuss this topic is Engineer Charles Akindayomi, President, Association of Consulting Engineers of Nigeria. We also have Mr. Olayemi Shonubi, Vice President, Nigerian Institution of Quantity Surveyors. Mr. Yemi Ijidiran, Managing Director, Wema Board Estates. And last but not the least, Mr. Kunle Awobudu is the first Vice President, Nigerian Institute of Building. He came all the way from Abuja for this event. All right, we would like to invite Engineer.
Gentlemen, we have 30 minutes to do this, and I intend to make sure that it is not more than 30 minutes. Building construction, the construction industry, has many challenges. Too many times, the clients are unhappy because we do not deliver the scope that they've given us. We do not deliver the quality that they desire. Many times, we overrun our budgets. Many times, we don't complete the project within schedule. Many times, there's actually disharmony sometimes, from time to time, among the members of the team. These are only some of the challenges of the construction industry. But the one that we are focusing on today is the challenge of delivery on time. Delivery on time. The stakeholders in the building can be categorized into about five. The clients themselves, what are their contributions to delays? What do they do to cause it? And what do they do to help it? The consultants who are entrusted with the responsibility of putting the project together, the contractors who have to construct the building, the suppliers and specialist suppliers and subcontractors who play different roles in the project, and the regulators, how do they hurt, how do they cause delays? These are the different stakeholders. The panel happens to be biased in favor of consultants. We have three consultants in the team, and only one developer. So the developer will probably give us an insight into the client's perspective, while the consultants will look at the different and probably try and cover both the role of the contractors and the other stakeholders. On my immediate right is the president of the Association for Consulting Engineering in Nigeria, Charles Akindayomi, who runs a consulting firm and has been in this industry for over 30 years. So let me start with him. Who causes the most delays in the construction industry? Is it the clients? Is it the consultants? Is it the contractors? Or is it the supplier? Who is it? Who is the culprit?
Okay, thank you, Bayo. And first of all, I would like to thank the Crystal Lawyer for inviting me to this podium to discuss this very important topic. Now, who causes delay, as is asked me? It all starts from the client. It's the client who carries most of the problems that we have in the construction industry. Now, why do I say that? A client may need a requirement for a building. He has in mind that, yes, I need to have that building. Now, sometimes the first person he calls in is the architect or the QS, not to be able to discuss their needs. Within them, they develop what you call either a project brief, or in terms of project management standard, they call it project charter. Now, that project brief is what is given to the consultants to use in order to be able to develop what that project is. But so many times in Nigeria, there's a lot of unspoken and unwritten objectives of the client. They will never tell you. Sometimes the project, before it takes off, is already moribund. It's not going to go nowhere. But they're not going to tell you. Now, the issue is that we need to get, if it's not the architect, a proper project manager needs to truly delve into the clients, what are their requirements there. Some of them will have personal interests, but they'll never let you know. Some of them is corruption, they'll never let you know. And when it comes to put them, even in government, majority of their project, they know it's not going anywhere, but they say, oh, they're going to do that project. So the issue is that the delay starts from there, although the other consultants and other players also do have. So there's a need to actually delve into the needs and the objectives of the client, properly put it down. Once you do that, and the rest of the team knows what the objectives are, then they'll be able to respond and do the project well. So I would say the first culprit is the client.
Thank you. Mr. Ejidere, the consultant has put the responsibility for delay on you after you have employed him and you have paid him. He thinks you are the one who is guilty. However, many clients have employed the best consultants that Nigeria has to offer. And despite the fact of employing the best consultants Nigeria have to offer, we have still suffered delays. What are your own thoughts on these? Not only the who has the responsibilities and the other root causes of these delays.
Thank you very much. Straight away, let me just say that it's important for the whole house to be fully aware that in any construction endeavor, the client usually put up a team of consultants to be able to advise and get involved in project management. The failure that causes project delay is essentially on the entire project team, not only the client alone. And I think it's important for us to emphasize that. A study was done recently covering almost about 100 projects, which led to about 50 litigation. And as a result of that outcome, various causes of delay were established. And principal among those causes has to do with issues that borders on integration, interface management issues in project delivery. Most clients usually love to put all their lives, their hope and their trust in the team they had assembled to deliver a project. But what happens in the course of the project is that, of course, probably due to lack of adequate requirement gathering, adequate interface management, change orders, and so many other poor planning issues, there are a series of delays that have been caused. So for me, I want to believe that the entire project team should be held responsible, not only one group. The reality of the matter is that we do not have lack of the skill set to be able to deliver projects on time and within budget. But we lack adequate process evaluation. We know some of the things that had happened in the past. How do we regenerate the process? Evaluate it in such a manner that it helps us to deliver on subsequent projects. And I think that is the main bane of the delays that we have in most of the project delivery. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, you can clap for him if you choose.
Bilda Awobodo,
a lot of consultants think that the problem is with the contractors. They think that sometimes the contractors don't have the competencies in terms of human resources. Sometimes they think they don't have the equipment. Sometimes they think they don't have the processes. Sometimes they think that there is a lot of conflict between the subcontractors, mechanical, electrical, and the main contractor. While we are not taking anything away from Engineer Akindayomi and Mr. Ejidiro, I want us to focus on the contractors in Nigeria, the contractors of the organization, and their contribution to project delays. What is it with the contractors?
Thank you, sir. When we talk of project management in Nigeria, you have always been a symbol of how projects should be delivered at the appropriate time. To say we don't have quite a lot of problems in respect of delay in Nigeria is to be economical with the truth. From my experience on various sites, buildability, lack of introducing this aspect of buildability when we are designing is quite responsible for some of the delays we had on site. I will just quickly cite an example. A high-rise building we are constructing in Ibadan had to be delayed in the aspect of installation of the lift. Why? There were some design errors, certain things that were not anticipated. There is a clear conflict between your dream, your abstract, what you are having in mind at the level of design, and on getting to site to transform into reality became a little bit difficult. So it necessitates the designer, the architect, the structural designer, to go back to the drawing table and re-engineer the space challenges that we have. And as you know, in project management, delay is expensive. Because we look at the parameters for project management, some of the areas of knowledge like cost management, quality management, time management, risk management, communication management, scope management, integration management, and they are very important, human resources management or procurement management. So these are very important for all the stakeholders on project. So, buildability should be a cause at design level. That is, you bring in the builder to look at the possibility, the challenges we are likely going to have when we are installing an aspect or, let's say, an element that has to do with lifting. So this is what I will also encourage our colleagues to do, that before you dish out your design, try and present it for a review for critics. When we were in school in those days, as you taught us, after you have designed, it will be pasted on the board for collective review and positive criticism. And then you go back to the drawing table and improve on your designs.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Ubud, although you didn't really focus on my request, so I'm going to extend that to Consulting Point Surveyor, Mr. Shunubi. Can you look into the construction? Because we've been dwelling on the consulting and the general management. I want us to drill with the construction phase of the project, where the project is in the hands of the contractor, the subcontractors, the suppliers. What are the root causes of delays in this space?
Thank you very much, sir. I would like, on behalf of Mr. Moshile, the President of Nigeria Institute of Quantity Surveyors, to extend his warm felicitations to the Crestal Laurel Limited on this occasion of their 25th anniversary. Why do we have delays, particularly at the construction level? For me, construction phase, that's what I said. I believe also there are about two, three things. First, the critical planning that is required before construction commences are not properly done. Two, there is not enough collaboration. I'll give you some certain instances. You're talking about, like Builder Obodu mentioned, you have a multi-story building that requires a lift. As at the time we are moving to site, you have not decided, agreed on the design for the lift, what kind of lift you should put in place, and then you go. And then you start the job, and somewhere along the line, because of the error in the design, the whole process stops. I won't put that at the foot of the contractor. I would rather bring in the consultant. Yes, the contractors have their issues. In between the main contractor and the subcontractors and the suppliers, you have issues. But if there are proper planning, for instance, the main contractor would have known who the subcontractors would be, they would have agreed on the planning in terms of the work program, the schedule, how the main contractor is going to work, how the subcontractors will work within the main contractor's program, such that there will be no conflict. Because usually that's where you have issues, where you have conflicts between, maybe the main contractor decides that, okay, today I want to work on the east wing. Whereas the subcontractors, the workmen he has engaged, have been engaged to work in the west wing. So at the end of the day, you have those conflicts. But paraventure, if the designs have been frozen prior to commencement of construction and have been fully developed, and that's why I was talking about planning, all this will have been eliminated. But you always find out that in most of the projects in Nigeria, this is always coming. Because the designers, that's the consultants, they get in hoping that as the project starts, they will do the design development, which normally will not happen. So we need a lot of collaboration for all the parties, the contractors, the consultants. We might want to blame the clients at times too, because they don't give approval as I went in. But then if they know what to do, they won't engage the professionals. I'm talking about the contractor and the consultants. But it's because they don't know jack as to how to go about the business. That is why they have engaged us, so-called professionals, construction professionals. And it is our responsibility to make sure that we give them the best in terms of planning and in terms of the way and manner the whole business is organized. Thank you.
Thank you. Move forward. You can see that the panel is consultants biased, and the insight we're looking for into what construction does to delay is still a little bit hidden. But we'll move on to the consequences of this delay. The delays have consequences on the clients. It has consequences on the consultants. It has consequences on the contractors. In fact, it has consequences on everybody. Let me start with Charles Akidayo. What are the most difficult consequences of delays? Is it on the clients or is it on the consultants? Who bears the brunt, the greatest brunt when projects are delayed?
Obviously, the investor, first of all, bears the greatest brunt.
But majority of our problems can be mitigated by proper selection. When you say proper selection of consultants, that's number one. Two, of contractors as well. So if you get those two right, that is, you make sure that the consultants you are selecting have the track record for that type of particular job, right? And the client himself is ready to pay commensurable fees for that consultant to do his job properly. And then taking it down the line, the contractors too, when you select them properly, I'm not saying there won't be any problem, but the problem can be mitigated and resolved, right? But in order to be able to stop all this, we have something in Nigeria where we call architects. They play dual roles in most of our projects. They are architects in one area and they're also project managers. That sort of trend must stop because it's creating a big problem for us, for all the construction team, because nobody's translating properly the wishes of the client and down the line for it to be carried out. And I believe strongly one of the problems we also have is that there's no consequences for actions here. If one or two people have been jailed and put in prison, it becomes, honestly, an example for people to stop what they are doing. You do something wrong, people just scold you, clients get the brunt because there's variation for work and so forth. Nobody's actually sanctioned whoever is the team, whether it's the architects or whether it's the other consultant or the contractors. We need to get ourselves in this country to a state that there must be consequences for our actions. If there's no consequences, we continue to be in this sort of situation we're in. Somebody must be penalized for whatever has gone wrong. So, or else is the client that bears the brunt that sometimes it does not have enough money to even complete the project because the operation, there's so much has gone wrong and it becomes abandoned. So is the client at the end who initiates the project, who wants the project done, that actually bears the majority of the problems.
Thank you. The quantity surveyor generally leads the preparation of contract documents. And one of the statements by Engineer Kalina is that we do not enforce conditions of contract. I'm not looking forward to the day where they will jail somebody for delay. I don't think it's a criminal offense. So, and what drives that is the conditions of contract. I'm back to you, Mr. Shonobi. What method of procurement will reduce delays to the minimum? And what do we need to do to enforce the conditions of contract that exist within the contracts that we sign to reduce delays?
For me, I think what we need to do first is to change our orientation, our culture of how we do things. You see, incidentally, most of us trade. For those that train abroad, for some that train under those who train abroad, we all have the same, background as to how this thing should be done. And we know how it is done in other countries. For instance, if you don't deliver on time, your client can sue you as a consultant for professional negligence. And that's why nowadays you have what you call professional indemnity insurance to indemnify your clients in case you don't perform according to the professional ethics. But unfortunately, we don't enforce such things here. One, people are afraid of going to court to even sue. Because for instance, if I've engaged you to deliver a project and you don't deliver, and I have made losses, I should take you to court and recover my losses. But people are not willing to test that. Because all these are inconditional contracts. There's usually every contract what you call liquidated and ascertained damages. That says that for every contract, if the contractor does not deliver when he's supposed to deliver, for every week that building remains unbuilt or completed, he's supposed to pay a certain amount per week. But because of the way we do things here, nobody is willing to enforce that. And in certain instances, when
But the consultants, you are supposed to enforce that.
No, we can only advise. Because, that is the honest truth. That's what is in the contract. You will advise a client that this is what you are entitled to deduct. You cannot even deduct it. It is the client that will make the deduction based on your advice. Because if you deduct it, the contractor can sue you and it will be justified. You can only advise. So, that's why I said we need to change our orientation. Once the clients become aware that they can sue and recover their losses. We are only talking about clients. We are not even talking about end users. Imagine somebody who has paid money in an estate. Now that you have developers building estates around, and then you have paid, and then because you have paid about 90% or even almost 100% for the particular house, you didn't pay the money that you are supposed to pay as rent in your former place, you didn't pay. And then the landlord in your place is harassing you. You cannot live where you are because the house you are supposed to move into has not been completed because the contractor did not deliver. So it's not only the client that is losing. Meanwhile, the man who has paid for that house probably paid through a mortgage from his office. So he's losing in so many ways. So there are so many people who are also losing. And back to the client, maybe the man even borrowed money and is paying rent and he cannot recoup or even start drawing down on the amount he has tied because the place is not completed. So every condition of contract has mitigating factors or conditions. But it now behoves on the owner, the developer, the client, to enforce that in moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jidunram, back to you. The question of contract delays, we've discussed this as if it's a Nigerian problem. But the knowledge in the world is that construction delay is universal, and it's not peculiarly Nigerian. And therefore, whether it's the Channel Tunnel that took 3 years later than it should be done, or Sydney Opera House that ran over budget and over several years, I think that the traditional Nigerian cause of it's us, I think in this discussion has dominated. In other words, are delays truly avoidable in the construction industry?
Thank you very much, sir. Absolutely, delays are avoidable. And it's important for us to move away from the realm of theory. We are not saying delays can be eliminated or cost overrun can be eliminated. But we're saying, are they avoidable? Can they be controlled, so to speak? Absolutely, yes. The reality of the matter is that in other jurisdictions of the world, when you sign a contract, you live by that contract. And I also dare to say that it may not be totally true that people are not also enforcing contract clauses here in Nigeria. I had worked in private development companies, and I know that we respect the letters of the contract just as well as we respect the spirit of the contract. And it is important for practitioners, consultants, developers, contractors, to be alive to the spirit and the letters of the contract. There are several contracts in the past where I had also worked upon that we have invoked relevant clauses of the contract, including penalties, liquidated and certain damages, and all that. So it is possible here, it is not strange. So whatever happens in other jurisdictions of the world can also happen here, and it is happening here. The reality of the matter is that most developers want returns on their investment. And I don't see any developer that will go into any development project and expect to lose upfront. So they expect returns. So once there is a delay, the onus is on the entire team. Again, I repeat, because this is teamwork. Project management is teamwork. It is important for the team to devise ways and means to be able to address resolution in a quick manner. So to answer your question, sir, the reality of the matter is that we want return on investment. Consultants must be alive to their responsibilities to advise the client, right? And I dare say that there is no client or developer who had borrowed funds from the bank and expect returns that will fold his arms and not invoke necessary clauses of the contract. I don't think so. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Finally, Elder Wobodu. Basically, your recipe is that we should add another consultant to the already large consulting team by having architects, structural engineers, electrical, and now we bring the builder in even at the design stage. Don't you think that that's just more theory, people? Because if the builder is a consultant, then he's not a contractor.
and therefore is looking at buildability only as a consultant. And therefore, over time, his ability to read buildability becomes a theoretical ability. Rather than, that's why we're looking at the method of procurement. In other words, if the project is jointly planned by the contractor, by the contractor and the consultant, does that give us a better chance of early integration than this consulting builder, who is at least just another layer on the bureaucracy?
Sir, I would say, I think there is a statue in Helsinki that on it there is this description: recognition of reality is the beginning of wisdom. If you have worked long on a site and you have documented causes of delay, the setbacks you had, you are bound to agree with me, based on experience, that there is this aspect of constructability, buildability, or maintainability that you really need to put into consideration when you are planning ahead. Because in most cases, when you are you are building your concept of design on a particular building. But when you get to site, at the point of constructing it as you planned, you might not get it. And based on that experience, that was why we are saying that the man who is in charge of construction on site will be able to guide you that this particular approach will not work. This one will cost you a lot of money to maintain in future. Therefore, why can't you review it? We have witnesses, we have learned from it, and we have also put it into practice. I will also quickly chip in this. Yes, contractors might have challenges or might lead the cause of delays. Let us look at it today. The Naira value has so much depreciated that most construction sites you go to, the plant and equipment being used there in Nigeria are imported fairly used. They are mostly tokumbos. And that is why you encounter frequent breakdown of plant and equipment on our side. From piling foundation, if you see most of the sites that we are doing piling here, like SSVI, most of them are imported. And imported as second-hand equipment. So, you are bound to have some delays because of maintenance issue. And that is why we are also appealing to some of our investors here that those plants and equipment should be manufactured within the country, like Crestra Lorraine, who is in joint partnership with Cone and others, should also try to invest in Nigeria by producing this thing locally, because of course, so the Naira has been so much debilitated that it's affecting us. So,
comment.
The delay finally, sir, the delay, as we know in project management, any project that suffers time overruns is as good as a failed project. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Last comment and brief, because our time is up.
Thank you, my director. I just want to, based on my over 30 years experience in this field, it's becoming very, very obvious that our projects cannot be managed properly and successfully without getting an additional consulting personnel in. And that additional consulting personnel is the project manager. Project managers must be on all our projects, because if you look at everything we do, even though if you are planning for a marriage, you will get an event planner. It's a project manager. So for a project that we are doing, we should stop using architects as project manager. We should get people or entities that are well qualified for this task to carry our job, and then majority of all the things we are discussing here will be mitigated, reduced. That is my own recommendation to our construction industry. Thank you.
Thank you. That's about as much we can take. You can see it's a big project topic. It's very wide, it's very complex. We haven't even touched the tip of the iceberg, but I hope you have been able to get one or two things from the discussion we've had. Thank you very much. Thank you. And thank you to the panel.